We've made it to Wednesday, and I'm going to tell you it's been a wonderful journey, and I'm glad to welcome each and every one of you to the archives today here on WCLU, the 5th day of June. And we are looking back a century's worth of history, 100 years that were, it was in the local publications, a lot of local news, news of citizens who were doing wonderful things and making a difference. And we'd like to show you the progression of getting to where we are. Mr. Sam Terry, well-known historian, a sort of a walking, living, breathing thesaurus of history around here. is that fair enough?
Well, I think that might be going a bit far.
But nonetheless, he is here ready to contribute to this program in a big way, as he also is involved in the retrieval of these archives, along with Gail Berry, Debbie Pace at the Cultural Center, and a whole big bunch of wonderful wonderful archivists who are looking for, who are doing the work of all this digging, like Rich Crow and Peggy Nims, Cheryl Amback, Janet Bowles. You'd be in good company if you wanted to help them out.
Absolutely.
1924, we start, the 5th of June. Mr. and Mrs. Felix N. Bradford and daughter Mary Frances leave Monday, where they will join the National Hardware Association members on a trip to California, stopping at Denver, Colorado Springs, and other points. From San Francisco, they will go south through Los Angeles, and on their return, they will stop at El Paso, Texas, where Mr. Bradford and his party will branch off for a trip to Old Mexico to visit Mr. Heiss Myers and family, returning home via New Orleans. Now, we're talking 100 years ago. Yes. My goodness. The highway system was, in some of those areas, probably non-existent, much less think about the travel and the, you know, spending the night, all that kind of stuff. That was kind of a hardware show, wasn't it?
It is. That's quite a trip.
19 and 24 it was. But they obviously learned a whole lot en route. It was this day in 1934 we got a Glasgow Times story that talks about the Dixie Tea Room, Sam. The Dixie Tea Room in Cave City. It's now open under the proprietorship of Mr. and Mrs. Oscar Longston. The Tea Room is on the Dixie Highway, just above the Mid-Continent Service Station. Features good old Southern cooking, regular meals, and short orders, along with bottled drinks, as well as curb service. It's the best place to eat between Louisville and Nashville. It's open all hours. That is they have a lot to boast about. It sounds to me like they took it head on. Hey, we're open all hours. Don't even stop between Louisville and Nashville because we're the best.
That's right. Sounds like a place we'd like to go.
That's right. 1934. It was 1944, in the Glasgow Times, this story is kind of neat. It's not exactly a matter of common knowledge, but a fact nevertheless, that was the celebrated radio star, Dinah Shore, made her debut right here in this section of Kentucky with the Roy Holmes Orchestra. Contract, now highly prized by Mr. Holmes, attests to this fact, though then she sang as Fanny Rose, which is her family name. She appeared with the orchestra at Sulphur Well, at Monticello, and various other engagements during the summer of 1937.
She did, and her connection to Glasgow was the Sam Green family.
Okay.
And they were all merchants here and down in Tennessee, where Fanny Rose, which actually was her name, lived and so forth, and she came here to visit quite often.
Well, and what a career that, if this was the start of her career, she made a lot of it for sure. Dinah Shore, 1944. It was 1954, this day in the Glasgow Times and Evening Journal, we have one of Barren County's roles in the Civil War noted. The fact the Glasgow Post Office was one of three in the state which was designated as Confederate. Did you realize that we had post offices that were designated Confederate or Union?
I did, actually.
Okay. Well, I mean, because you're just smart, but I'm fascinated by that. Those in Bowling Green, one-time Confederate headquarters, and at Columbus honored the Southern postage stamps on mail passing through. Materials gathered by the city clerk Malcolm Smith as a hobby indicates that no stamps were actually used by the Glasgow Post Office, but rather the letters were franked with a rubber stamp. Such a postmark would be very valuable among collectors today, according to Mr. Smith. I would say that it would.
I would say it would be quite valuable.
Pretty rare, too, I would think. So if you got one, you got a letter there that had been franked with a rubber stamp, investigate it further. 1964, Glasgow High School valedictorian was announced. It's Carol Ann Mays, and the salutatorian is Kenneth Bowden. The Temple Hill valedictorian is Claudette Price. The salutatorian is Martha Ellen Depp. And third honors go to Patricia Depp. Out at Hicesville, the valedictorian is Mary Lou Craighead. The salutatorian is Carol Ann Ford. Do we not have some smart folks here in the class of 64?
Wow.
My goodness. Bunch of nice folks indeed from 1964. Honor students. Let's move to 1974, Sam. We have some information about members of the Barren County Athletic Boosters met with the county school board. They agreed they will try to raise money for lighting the football field. Of course, this is in the early days of Barren County High School being a countywide high school. And what a gentleman. Clyde Sally was the spokesman for the group. And, you know, nobody could be more clearly spoken than Clyde was. Of course, we lost him just a few weeks ago. But he was very much active in getting the Barren County football stadium lit and getting the football program up and running, and we have a lot of people to thank for that.
Well, a good foundation for what we have there today.
That's right.
My goodness.
This day in 1984, Dorothy McKinney has been promoted to the assistant manager of the Credit Thrift of America, which is an office located at 699 Happy Valley Road. Nice lady indeed, Miss Dorothy McKinney. It was 1994. Was this 94? Hold on, I'm getting ahead of myself here, Sam. I got stuff stuck together. It was 1994. We learned about winners of the Mabel Shelby Wells Historical Essay at Park City School. First place, Lindsay Gardner, from Ancestral Acres is where she's from.
Well, that was the subject of her essay.
Oh, okay. All right, that was the subject of it. All right. Lindsay Gardner Ancestral Acres was the subject of her essay. Tasha Nicole Proctor, Mammoth Cave, was her subject. Casey Ann Button, The Great Mammoth Cave. This essay contest is sponsored by South Central Kentucky Historical and Genealogical Society, something that Sam Terry knows a whole lot about, including Mabel Shelby Wells.
Indeed, and the Historical Society, of course, changed its name to the Barren County Historical Society a few years ago, and continues to give scholarships, mm-hmm. But in a little bit different organization today.
2004, the 17th reunion of the Blackhawks was held at the South Central Kentucky Cultural Center. This group saw first action on the Rhine River in World War II. This year's reunion was hosted by group member Larry Calhoun of Finney. I just think that is so interesting. It's something, as a group of people that first were together on the Rhine River in World War II come to Glasgow for a reunion. Very impressive indeed.
I would agree.
And it was 2014 this day that we have Joann's Fabrics officially opening its doors for business back on May the 29th, but they had a newspaper article in the Progress about Joann's Fabrics opening up in 2014.
Goodness, doesn't seem like it's been 10 years.
But it has. That's why we go back and try to put this history into perspective, Sam.
It certainly is.
We learn a lot about ourselves and how we got here, and in a strange way, we get to figure out kind of where we're going. And we'll come back tomorrow and share more history on the archives. We hope you will join us.